Welcome to the 2014 commencement ceremony for the University of Minnesota Rochester. To begin, I ask that you please rise for the singing of our national anthem by the UMR Ketones.
Stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. O'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave
seated. Thank you, Ketones. You'll hear from them perform again during the recessional. Well, students, are you ready for this? Everybody in a crowd, are you ready for this? That's better. It was so quiet walking in. It's a great day to celebrate your hard work and achievements, the innovative work by your faculty and staff, and the deep commitment of your Rochester community to your success. I would now introduce the UMR Commencement Stage Party. You will find the names of these distinguished guests on page 2 of your program. To my far right is the Grand Marshal, Marilyn Stewart. Marilyn, could you please stand? Thank you. Let us recognize Marilyn right now for what she's done to put the R in UMR. Next to Ms. Stewart is Dr. Michael Silber. Dr. Silber is the Dean of the Medical School of Health Sciences, which is our educational partner for the Health Professions Program. Next to Dr. Silber is Jay Hesley. He is the Assistant Vice Chancellor for Institutional Advancement. Gail Sauter, UMR's Associate Vice Chancellor for Operations and Finance. Dr. Molly Dingle, Directorship Chair for the UMR Center for Learning Innovation. The Honorable Patricia S. Simmons, University of Minnesota Board of Regents. Dr. Simmons, one of our own from Rochester, is here to officially confer degrees on the students. Our stage party also includes a faculty speaker, Dr. Peter Larson, and our student speakers, Julie Reisinger and Jessica Wycheck. I will share more about them later. We are also honored today to welcome President Eric Kaler. I want to personally thank the President for being in Rochester today to join us in our celebration, especially given the many commencement ceremonies occurring on the 5 campuses of the University of Minnesota. I also want to take this opportunity to thank him publicly for his outstanding leadership at the University of Minnesota and for his support of its campus here in Rochester. And students, he is the one responsible for the tuition freeze. I just want to. I also would like to introduce Timothy Klein to stand. He's in the back row there. Tim is the first Rochester-based student who will receive a Doctor of Philosophy in the Biomedical Informatics and Computational Biology program. To us insiders, it's known as BICBI. And joining Tim is his faculty advisor, Dr. Eric Rittman, who is a professor of medicine and physiology at Mayo Clinic, and Dr. Claudia Neuhauser, who's director of graduate studies for the BICB program. Now, many of you know, Dr. Neuhauser is the UMR's former vice chancellor for academic affairs and the visionary architect for the overall academic experience at UMR. So please welcome the entire stage party. In front of the stage are members of the University of Minnesota Rochester's faculty, as well as faculty from the Mayo School of Health Sciences. Let me take this moment to thank them. They are truly the most innovative and committed faculty that I've had the pleasure to work with over the course of my career. Students, please stand, turn to them, and recognize how awesome faculty you have. Right there they are. They make UMR the best undergraduate program in the health sciences in the nation. And finally, though not on stage, there are many UMR staff in the audience today, and many of them are actually working this event. So could I ask you please just a quick round of applause for them, because they really make UMR special. It is now my pleasure to introduce the 16th president of the University of Minnesota, President Eric Kaler. President Kaler is completing the third year of his presidency. He is an internationally renowned expert on complex fluids, which has applications in drug delivery, food processing, pharmaceuticals, and manufacturing. He was elected to the prestigious National Academy of Engineering in 2012, and was also recognized just this past April by being named into the American Academy of Arts and Sciences for both his work in chemical engineering, but also as a higher education administrator. Please give a warm Rochester welcome to President Eric Kaler.
Good morning. Good morning. Thank you, good. Regent Simmons, welcome, and thank you for your outstanding leadership of this university. Chancellor Lehmkuhl, you have built a national model for higher education innovation and community engagement, and I thank you for putting the University of Minnesota Rochester boldly on the map. Distinguished faculty, family members, friends, welcome. And of course, to the class of 2014, congratulations. 32 years ago, I graduated from the University of Minnesota. I walked in your shoes. So if they're a little out of style, it's my fault. Seriously, I was graduating from the University of Minnesota with a PhD in chemical engineering. Back then, probably like you today, if someone asked, I would have honestly answered that I was that day living at the intersections of pride and fear, of happiness and uncertainty, and of ambition and apprehension. I wondered, was this degree my ticket to fame and fortune, or just one more step on the way to that awkward question, Mom, can I move back in? I did learn at least one very important thing during my time at the university, and it was this. To use a technical term, stuff happens. Often, it's good stuff. When I first arrived in Minneapolis as a fresh-faced PhD student, my goal was to be the youngest senior vice president in the history of Exxon. I was going to get a PhD, I was going to go to industry, and that's what I was going to do. But one day, in the third year of my PhD work, my advisor, who was also the chair of the department, came to my office. Now, if you don't know, you will learn. When your boss comes to your office, it's either really, really good or really, really bad. This was really good. He had somehow come up short in his teaching roster for the fall, and he needed somebody to teach a course in process control. If you know what that is, good. If you don't, it doesn't matter. And he asked me if I would do that. And I asked what every graduate student would ask, which was, what does it pay? and it paid more than I was making as a research assistant. So I said, sure, Ted, I'll be happy to teach that class. Now, what I didn't tell him, and he did not ask, is that although I had an undergraduate chemical engineering degree from Caltech, I had never taken a class in process control. Never taught a class, never taken a class in process control. It just didn't seem the right time to bring that up right there. And it wasn't a problem. I learned it, I taught it, and I had a wonderful time. I had a great connection with the students, I enjoyed it immensely, and the students seemed to suffer no permanent harm. So teaching that course changed the course of my life, and I think Exxon's done just fine without me. I became a professor that I never expected to be. So as you sit here in your shoes, know that sometimes life finds you, and when it does, it catapults you in directions you didn't know about and puts you in places you never expected. Unfortunately, these days, there are some critics who question the value of a college education. They are wrong. No one can devalue the work that you've put in and the passion you have brought to it. No one can argue against the hard facts about graduates of this great campus that speak to the value of your degrees. Don't tell anybody else. But according to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, healthcare and health-related occupations will account for about one-third of all job growth in the United States over the next decade. Now, not all of you are going to get the dream job you want right out of school. But your hard work in getting to this day and what you produce for society and your community will be rewarded. Come to think of it, maybe you won't have to move back in after all. Now, as president of the University of Minnesota, I am constantly assessing conditions on all of our campuses. And I believe one very important part of your time here is the student experience. You know, friends, romances, late night conversations, life skills. So in preparation for my time with you today, I have conducted extensive research on what I suspect will be your top 10 memories of your UMR years. So see how you like these. Number 10, telling other people, yes, I go to college in Rochester, and yes, it's a real school, and no, it's not RCTC, and yes, it's in a mall, it's in a mall. Two words, Bridge Street shenanigans. Zach Domeyer yelling, jump, on the elevator, and way too many of you getting stuck on it for way too long. Is Zach here? Yeah. Good job, buddy, yeah. Having dinner at Chancellor Lehmkuhl's house, which was a great honor, but what was really cool was having Chef Johnny cater the meal. Knowing more about your professors than any college student on any other campus will ever know. Number 5, traveling to campus on days you didn't have classes just to get free food. Number 4, voting enthusiastically for UMR's school mascot, thinking, assuming it was going to be a velociraptor. But somehow it turned into that bird thing. Number 3, defeating the faculty while winning the Countdown Cup your freshman year. Number 2, playing tag through Peace Plaza during orientation week and understanding very early on the chancellor's wisdom that all of Rochester is, in fact, your campus. And then number 1, class of 2014 memory, according to my research, Wednesday nights, Bargo, and Applebee's. Memories. From orientation to today, to this personal capstone, a true personal achievement. But more importantly, for this campus, like all of our public research campuses, your degree and your knowledge and your potential is very much also a public good, a critically important public good for the state and nation. Now, those are not the kind of things I thought about 32 years ago when I graduated, but it is something that I will think about for the next 32 years when in 2046 I will turn 90 years old. Some of you may well be taking care of me then. But it got me to thinking what, at age 90, I might write back to that newly minted PhD in 1982. What might I write to that youthful Eric if I could travel back in time? I might write, "Dear Eric, as you embark on your career, find the path that is right for you, not for your parents to brag or your friends to impress, not simply to boost your ego, but to do work that will change your community and the world for the better. And if you're lucky, very lucky, you will also find a loving partner to do that with." Or I might write, "Dear Eric, be graceful. From time to time, there's a chance you will fail, but gracefully pick yourself up and learn from your mistakes. I promise you that the work and actions that will trigger the fewest regrets are those in which you took the biggest risks." Or I might write, "Dear Eric, stop worrying. Celebrate this great day of achievement. You've graduated. Your parents, your friends, your partners, they are so proud of you." So graduates, in the years to come, create your own authentic personal story. Fill it with great surprises. And know that already on this day, each one of you owns a story of abundant success. I also know that never in history has there been a graduation after which someone said, "Boy, I wish that guy had talked longer." Congratulations and Godspeed.
Well, I will now introduce the student and faculty speakers. Our first student speaker will be Jessica Wycheck. Jessica is from St. Michael, Minnesota. She's an example of a student who utilizes the full set of educational resources available to her. She attended college full-time during her senior year in high school through post-secondary enrollment option on the Twin Cities campus. She enrolled at UMR in a health sciences program and then was admitted only after 1 year into the health professions program to study sonography at the Mayo School of Health Sciences. She has volunteered at Ronald McDonald House and has done mission work in Mexico. Upon graduation, Jessica will be employed by the Mayo Clinic as a diagnostic medical sonographer. The second student speaker is Julie Reisinger, a graduate of the Health Sciences program. She is from Roseville, Minnesota. Julie is was president of the Rochester Student Association, volunteered at Good Samaritan Medical Clinic, which is a clinic associated with the Salvation Army, and just returned on Wednesday, I believe, from a study abroad experience in Siena, Italy. She will begin her Doctor of Osteopathic Medicine program at Des Moines University in the fall. And Dr. Peter Larson, our faculty speaker, has been with UMR from the start. He is from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, a graduate of Luther College, and did his graduate work at the University of Kansas. He also did his postdoctoral work at Max Planck Institute. My favorite student quote about Dr. Larson: "He was sent to us from heaven." Jessica, Julie, and Peter were selected by the students to speak at the commencement ceremony. So, Jessica.
Good morning, fellow graduates, professors, administration, family, friends, and honored guests. A little over 5 years ago, I visited Rochester for the first time while my grandpa was having testing done at Mayo Clinic. It only took me a few hours of taking in the city, the people, and the atmosphere to know that Rochester was exactly where I needed to be. Though I was a sophomore in high school at the time, I knew I would be back again someday. That day was the beginning of the journey that led me to where I am today, standing here before you. 2 years later, with my heart and mind set on the sonography program at Mayo, I began school at UMR. Though the spirit of the city itself was enough to motivate me, I was even more inspired by the small class sizes and individual instruction. Here I was in a city that stirred up passion in me, surrounded by a school and community striving for excellence. It was truly a university unlike any other. It had a collaborative learning model, which was ideal for students preparing for the medical profession. There were common areas that brought professors and students even closer together. These open spaces and intimate settings fostered a different kind of school life where students could grieve over a rough day or spend hours discussing exams and assignments, or perhaps most importantly, come to discover the bigger picture of who they are and where they are going. And then there were the staff and the administration that not only knew their students by name, but genuinely cared about their students' success and ambitions. Clearly, this was a college unlike any other. Classmates, we share this common piece of life, these college years that have prepared us for our future. As I reflect on all the things I've learned throughout the BSHP program, I find that some of the most valuable lessons did not come from the books or the lectures or the countless hours of studying. Some of the most valuable lessons that I will take away from these years come from what Mayo Clinic, the university, and this community have taught me about three very important ideas: hope, compassion, and excellence. I believe this place has taught us what hope looks like, what it feels like, and how important it is. I've heard stories from patients themselves who came to Mayo Clinic because there is hope here. They come because it surrounds the hospitals, it shows in the thousands of tulips and flowers planted around the city, and most importantly, it radiates from the countless care providers who walk alongside patients every day as they fight their health battles, tirelessly pushing them forward, and we have been a part of this. Our education has taught us what patient-centered care looks like. Whether it's taking an extra 5 minutes to listen to an anxious patient or staying late to fit a patient into the schedule so they can fly back home a day earlier, patient-centered care makes a great difference. No matter what degree we are leaving with and no matter where we are going, we will always have the opportunity to choose what mark we leave on our place of employment and how we impact the lives of those around us. Lastly, our education has taught us what excellence looks like. Training in an environment where professionals continue to strive for the best they can be is truly inspiring and motivating. It is made for the best learning environment both in the classroom and in the field. And I challenge each one of us to take this same mindset with us as we move forward in our own careers, as professionals that aspire to excellence just like those who taught us. Reflecting on these experiences, I realize that we are walking away with so much more than a diploma and an education. We are walking away with lessons and experiences that have ultimately shown us what it takes to make a difference in our world. Our training and education have not only equipped us with the knowledge and skills we need to deliver high-quality healthcare, but it has shown us how to hope with our patients, how to put their needs before our own, and how to give them the best care possible. So let's recap. We've received an education like no other, from a school like no other, where excellence and collaborative learning create real-life stories of people living in hope and medical professionals providing hope. Regardless of the road we take, or the degree we've earned, or the city we call home, let's always remember what we've shared here together and bring it forward as we open new doors. I'm truly proud to stand here with each of you, knowing and believing that we are now the difference in healthcare, and that who we have become and what we take with us will make a difference in the world we face. Congratulations, UMR Class of 2014.
Ciao, ragazzi. Congratulations, we made it. It does not seem like 4 years ago that we all walked up the stairs to University Square, a little unsure of what we were getting into, and yet here we are, 4 years later at graduation. Where did the time go? To those late night anatomy sessions, to pulling out our hair from the newest biochemistry topic, or to long chats in the commons when we should have been studying. We accepted the challenge of an unknown adventure and have now successfully made it to the end. The day that I was asked to speak, I was on spring break in Turkey with Travis, so I thought it would be appropriate to share a story with you all today from our trip. Mom, plug your ears. One day in Turkey, we headed to Pamukkale, a natural calcium hot springs that was a hot, cramped 3-hour van ride away. We were almost there, and our tour guide announced the best way to see the hot springs and the Greek ruins was to parasail over them. and that he would easily organize a trip for anyone that wanted to go. Maybe it was because of the heat in the van, or maybe it was because of Travis's past skydiving experience that I knew right away, without a second thought, that we would skip lunch and sail through the sky. It wasn't long and we were transferred to another van to drive up the mountain. I assumed we would be taken to a nice building, have a nice long safety lesson before suiting up and going. Once we got to the top of the hill, though, I quickly remembered that we weren't in the United States anymore. There was a small building that wasn't much more than a bathroom. We were each guided to a parasailer who quickly began suiting us up. It was at this moment that it all hit me. There would be no safety course. We didn't sign a liability form, and I didn't have my health insurance card on me. What were we doing? Now, for those of you that know me, this type of spur-of-the-moment adventure sport isn't necessarily my typical activity. But at this point on the mountain, I knew three things. One, this would be the only way I would ever do anything like this. Two, there was no backing out because the sail was already clipped on. And third, my legs were shaking. Finally, my guide gave me a few instructions for our flight. He told me where I should hold on to the sail, how to hold on to his camera, and that as we took off, I should just keep running. And that was it. Another man from our group took off, and then it was my turn. I was shorter than my guide, and my legs were still shaking, but all I knew that I just had to just keep running. So that's what I did. Before I knew it, we were flying in the air, smoothly sailing. The view was gorgeous and beyond anything that I could have imagined. All my worries went away, and I just enjoyed the flight. That was until I realized I didn't know how we were going to land. Luckily, my guide finally told me what to do. He yelled, "Just keep running and don't sit down." Okay, perfect. I thought, it can't be that hard. And then I watched the man before me wipe out in the dust. I was convinced that I would break my foot. Again. I told myself to enjoy the end of the ride and to just keep running. It was my turn to land, so we flew over to a grassy spot. I tried my best to stand up out of the seat that I was in. I think it was a parachute, but who knows? And I just kept running. Since I was short, I had no choice but to sit down, but I like to think it was graceful. And thankfully, no one got hurt. Either way, it was better than Travis's face-first wipeout. But somehow we had done it. We made it safely and had a great ride. We have all made it here safely today and have had a great ride over the last 4 years. We took the leap to attend a university with only one other class without really knowing what we were getting ourselves into. We had 4 years together with plenty of twists and turns, and we have all successfully made it to the end. We are all leaving here today on the top of our next mountain. This time we will take different paths, whether it be to graduate school, medical school, a job, or maybe you don't know. But if UMR hasn't prepared us for anything else, you are all professionals at handling the unknown and the ambiguous. But if you ever get to a point in your life when your legs start shaking, there's only one thing you must do. Just keep running. Thank you and congratulations to all.
Julie, Jessica, thank you. Congratulations, UMR class of 2014. You deserve this. And I know that for a few of you, because for a few of you, your very first day at UMR was with me. Tuesday, day after Labor Day, 8 a.m. organic lab. And I'm pretty sure Julie was there. So for me, it feels especially poignant that I'm asked to speak here today. Symmetric. And while I don't know everyone's course load, I know that in the unique environment of UMR, almost everyone took a math or chemistry class at some point. And so while I may lose some of our guests out there, I feel like we have a common language to draw from. Also, I'm a chemistry teacher. So what did you expect I was going to do up here? When I was in high school, I took chemistry for the first time. And I learned an equation, PV equals NRT. ideal gas law. And I was told that this equation would allow me to talk about gases in terms of parameters like pressure, volume, and temperature. And that worked through high school, undergraduate. And when I got to graduate school, my advisor told me that this equation had a much better, deeper meaning. He told me that it's a model that we can use to evaluate our decisions, evaluate our research. If we take our equation and rearrange it to N equals PV over RT and reassign the variables, N is the goal that we are trying to maximize. Publications, students graduated, happiness. P is the probability of success. V is the value of the endeavor. And R is the resources we invest, and T is the time that we devote. Thus, we want a high probability of success on high value endeavors, and if we can get them instantaneously for free, all the better. Parents and guests, if you don't understand this, please ask our graduates. They really, really oughta. Today, we're in a very unique position because we've completed a major undertaking, and so we know a lot of the pieces of this equation. In graduate school and beyond, I took this model to heart. And in that context, it's grown. Because as I've gotten older, what I've realized is that the problems to which I apply this model are much more complicated. Some of the most valuable and rewarding endeavors that we engage in are not always guaranteed of success, and the resources and the time that we invest are significant. Will the value be worth it? For you today, you can attest to the resources and time that you have invested here, the sacrifices that you and your family have made to see you reach this point. But in some ways, in terms of our equation, that's easy to evaluate. Those are fixed quantities. We know what's been put in. P is the probability of success. And today we know that that value also is 100%. Congratulations to all of you. So I think the reason that I'm asked to speak here today is to help you find meaning in the culmination of this experience, to help you find the V, the value of the endeavor. And they gave me 5 minutes to do it. UMR is a very small place. We all know each other. I know everyone's name who's sitting there right now. You know each other's course loads. You certainly have gained a lot of insight from forming study groups with students of diverse backgrounds. You like to help each other. And while I can attest to the personal growth that one finds in teaching others, and there are certainly insights to be gained from working in groups, I think your motives are much more pure than that. You work together because you care about one another. Now, in typical teacher fashion, I'm going to dodge the question of the value of the endeavor, because ultimately, I really can't answer that for you. Our experiences inform who we become, and the meaning that we take from these experiences is deeply personal. What I can do is answer the question of value for me. Meaning. The experience of education has allowed me to become a more reflective person about my life, my experiences, the world around me, and my place within it. Joy. The experience of having so many of you as students has allowed me to experience the joy that can only be found in serving one another. The support that you have learned to give and receive, the character that you demonstrate, has allowed you to take the risks necessary to be here today. And perhaps those are the more fundamental and overarching themes to an education, the development of a very human trait, the ability to identify meaning in the experiences that we have. Congratulations, class of 2014. May you continue to identify the value.
Get my place here. We will now present to you the Doctor of Philosophy candidate. The Director of Graduate Studies, Claudia Neuhauser, please come forward.
Thank you, Chancellor M. Kuhl. It's good to be back here. And it's a special day for us to celebrate both your undergraduate graduation and our first graduate from Rochester campus in a PhD program, Bioinformatics and Computational Biology. And I know that the community particularly was waiting for this day. And so I would like to invite both Dr. Eric Rittman and the Biomedical Informatics and Computational Biology PhD candidate to the front of the stage. Dr. Rittman will now hood PhD candidate Timothy Lee Klein. So it is with great pleasure that I present to you Dr. Timothy Lee Klein, PhD, Biomedical Informatics and Computational Biology.
It is now my great pleasure to present the 2014 University of Minnesota Rochester degree candidates for the Bachelor of Science in Health Professions and the Bachelor of Science in Health Sciences.
And now to present the candidates for the Bachelor of Science in Health Professions. Brianna Homan, Radiography. Marissa Rose Morris, Radiography. Sarah Preve, Radiography. Amy Wilson, Radiography. Dustin Scott Alden, Respiratory Care. Abby Evavold, Respiratory Care. Amanda Friedman, Respiratory Care. Jared Cecil Inglett, Respiratory Care. Phoebe Teenman Kermy, Respiratory Care. Mohammed Jama Mohammed, Respiratory Care. Danielle Alyssa Montet, respiratory care. Grace Offered, respiratory care. Matthew Taminga, respiratory care with distinction. Jaden Wilhelm, respiratory care with high distinction. Tina Pranjic, sonography. Jessica Wycheck, sonography with high distinction. Now to present the candidates for the Bachelor of Science in Health Science, Bree Allman. Eunice Oluwatofume Akintade. Zachary Michael Albrecht. Eric Awa. Nicholas James Jew Baker. Carissa Bamlett. Luke Bennett. Elsa Benson. Daniel Bergeson. Hannah Bergeson. Josh Clancy. Brittany Marcel Clemen. Camden Davey. Catherine Davidson. Zachary James Domeyer. Lisa Dooley. Melissa Erlinson. Daniela Espinoza. Travis John Geyer with high distinction. Trisha Lynn Harstead. Ashley Hugdahl. Courtney Hayduck with distinction. Timothy Horn. Lindsay Hubbard. Lucas Lee Jacobson. Ruby Kaiser. Amanda Clausen. Kimberly Ann Klatt. Emily Majeris. Gavin Mark. Chase J. Mullenbach. Chelsea Myrie.
That's my girl.
Akil Nehra. Rachel Wynn. Evan Nikolai with distinction. Samuel Orabamas. Abby Panko. Alex Peterson. Julie Elise Reisinger with distinction. Holly Clarice Ruthier. Megan Sable. Yeah. Danielle Sobraski. Tony Sanchez. Kate Scheffler. Luke Joseph Edward Schulte. Christy Simonson. Jessica Solberg. Josh Somers. Angel Spooner. V. Huynh Ta. Andrew Thomas Tessing. Michaela Velvick. Sydney Michael Vandal.
I would now like to invite the Honorable Regent Simmons to the podium to confer the degrees. Regent Simmons.
Thank you. Thank you, Chancellor. And I recognize that when you're from a community, the honorable doesn't always work. So for those of you who know me well, know my daughter refers to me as the lovable and mostly honorable Patricia Simmons. Will the 2014 graduating class of the University of Minnesota Rochester please rise. Now, ladies and gentlemen, there's a little more business at hand before we get to the final step of conferring your degrees. And I'd like to ask you to turn around about 180 degrees, face out to the people sitting in front of you, above you, beside you. These are people who care so deeply about your success, who've supported you through your time of education. I thought you might like to give them a round of applause. And now, if you'd be so kind as to turn back around and face me. Upon the recommendation of the faculty, and by the authority of the Regents of the University of Minnesota, I now confer upon you the degrees for which you have qualified. Congratulations, graduates. Now, there's a little tradition at this university and many universities where once you've graduated, and you now have, you move your tassel from the right to the left. Now, there you go. Those of you who had already done it, come back next year and we'll try again. I'm so pleased to welcome you to the world of university graduates, and now I'll ask Chancellor Lehmkuhl to please come back to us to complete our program. Chancellor.
Well, I now can say graduates. That sounds good, doesn't it? I can guarantee that without hard work, you will not succeed. But I cannot guarantee that with hard work, you will succeed. So when you succeed working hard, we need to celebrate. You have worked hard, and you have been successful. And I know that many of you have already been accepted to attend medical school, osteopathic programs, graduate programs in naturopathic medicine, physical therapy, occupational therapy, forensic psychology, biophysics, and others. I know that some of you are working as a consultant for doing health informatics for a hospital, or working in echocardiography, sonography, radiography, or respiratory care at Mayo Clinic and other locations. I also know that 80% of you who started with us are graduating today in 4 years. You've heard me say, and I know a lot of you are saying, I've heard it too many times, I love you all, but you need to get out of here in 4 years. Another way for me to say this today, we love you more when you finish in four. I thought that was pretty good. So you have worked hard, absolutely, and you have succeeded in amazing ways. So it is time to celebrate. So one more piece of business. Graduates, you want to throw your hats? Now wait. Okay, this has become sort of a tradition, but I have to warn all the community members, be careful about flying objects from the sky. Faculty, you've had things thrown at you before, you know what to do. Those of you who want to get a picture, now's the time to load your camera. Or get ready, okay. On the count of three. Wait a minute, you're gonna do it or not? You wanna stand? All right. On the count of three. One, two, three. I would like to ask that all of you remain seated until the recessional is complete. I welcome you to join the graduates for refreshments immediately following the ceremony in the Grand Ballroom, which you can reach by going through the door on my left, and then you'll see it on your right. I now pronounce the 2014 commencement ceremony for the University of Minnesota Rochester closed.
might seem crazy what I'm about to say.
Do, 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 do.
Sunshine, she's here, baby, by the way.
Do, 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 do.
Hot air balloon, make you go to space.
Do, 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 do.
Yeah, like I don't care, baby, by the way.
Do, 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 do.
Because I'm happy.
Clap along if you feel like a room without a roof.
Because I'm happy.
Clap along if you feel like happiness is the truth.
Because I'm happy.
Clap along if you know what happiness is to you.
Because I'm happy.
Clap along if you feel like a room without a roof. Here comes bad news, talking this and that.
Do, 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 do.
Give me all you got and don't hold it back.
Do, 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 do.
I should probably warn you, I'll be just fine.
Do, 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 do.
No offense to you, don't waste your time.
Do, 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 do,
because I'm happy.
Clap along if you feel like a room without a roof.
Because I'm happy.
Clap along if you feel like happiness is the truth.
Because I'm happy.
Clap along if you know what happiness is to you. Clap along if you feel like a room without a roof. It might seem crazy what I'm about to say.
Do, 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 do.
Sunshine, she's here, you can make a break.
Do, 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 do.
Like a balloon that could go to space.
Do, 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 do.